Today we're going to talk about authority and power. Last week, the Lord met us in a powerful way as we focused on the name above all names, that glorious, marvelous name of Jesus. And what amazing a privilege it is, church, that Jesus delegated to us his authority, that we, in turn, might learn to use his authority to grow into his likeness and to take his message to the world. Authority is defined as the right to enforce laws, to require obedience, to command, to determine, or to judge. Some people despise authority. Some fear it. But the Bible says there is no authority except the authority that comes from God Almighty. That's the only one really that exists. We see it in Romans 13. Everyone must submit to governing authorities. For all authority comes from God, and those in positions of authority have been placed there by God. So anyone who rebels against authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and they will be punished. For the authorities do not strike fear in people who are doing right, but in those who are doing wrong. Would you like to live without fear of the authorities? Then do what's right, and they will honor you. Now, when Jesus came to Earth, church, commissioned by the Father to accomplish redemption for us, for anyone who would who believed, he set a program in order that you and I, if we believe in him, could live forever with him and could go to heaven to be with him. As the Son of Man, his submission to that commission is what granted him the authority to carry it out. In other words, his obedience to having been commissioned by God to given a duty, a responsibility, an order, instructions by God, that's the commission by God, this is what you're supposed to do. Had Jesus not submitted to that commission, you and I would not have a plan today to go to heaven. No one can be commissioned or appointed or assigned, however you want to call it, to a position or calling without first submitting to the position or calling that they have been given. Therefore, whatever we do in life as a job or a career or a calling, we are to do it in such a way as to demonstrate Jesus to those around us. That is your commission, my commission. That is what we've been called to do. Now, we know that we have authority. We know that because Jesus gave us authority. It is a gift from God. However, though, we must understand how to use that authority. And we must also understand the difference between authority and power. These are the definitions that the Lord gave, so you might want to jot them down. They're very simple. Power is the ability to do something. Authority is the right to do something. There are powerful people in the body of Christ who have absolutely no authority. Don't be swayed by people's power. It may not be authorized power. And yet, from observation of all these years, you know, I can tell you that people normally in the church hunt power. So don't confuse power with authority. Jesus explained that principle this way in Matthew 7. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. You see, church, a disciple under authority is far more effective than the disciple who has power but is not under authority.
Amen.
You can have power because the Holy Spirit dwells within you, but use that power outside the authority of what Jesus Christ has given to you. The devil is not afraid of your power. He's afraid of your authority. The reason he's not afraid of your power is because power often leads to pride. Now, that power can show itself in all kinds of things. It can show itself in signs and wonders. It can show itself in singing. It can show itself in preaching. It can show itself in teaching. It can show itself in many different ways, the power can. But, and if one is not careful, you can end up with pride. And if pride comes as you let the power show in your life, because you have power. If you're born again, you have power. And if you aren't careful, you can move in power with your anointing, and you equate anointing with a power and with authority. They are not necessarily the same. Authority, church, comes from being under authority, from obedience to the voice of God. In other words, there are many traveling evangelists, traveling healing ministries, or all different kinds of people who will come into the church, and sometimes not only do they come in, but they will not submit to the authority of the church. If that is so, they are out of authority.
Amen.
Or people will come with great giftings and will join a church, and yet if they do not submit to the authority of the church, they will also be out of order. And the blessing that God intends to bring back on their lives will not be there. Does anybody understand what I'm saying? These folks that he was talking about, Jesus said in that Matthew scripture, had prophesied, they had cast out demons, they'd even done signs and wonders. They moved in power. Jesus says they moved in power. But then he declares this frightening truth. I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Now, we could put it this way. You who do things on your own ability, not my authority.
Right.
Or let's qualify things by saying, what is lawlessness? This is lawlessness. The condition are being unauthorized, unrestrained, uncontrolled by law, lacking legitimacy. In other words, this is what Jesus was saying. Yes, you did those things, and people were blessed because my word carries with it blessings. So the people were blessed, but you forfeited your blessings by using my power in you without my direction or my permission.
Amen.
Amen.
Have you forgotten, Jesus says, that I did nothing except what I saw my Father do? Have you forgotten that I didn't even speak a word unless I heard my Father? Do you remember that though I heal many, I did not heal everyone because I only did what the Father told me to do?
Amen.
And of course, the guy at the Pool of Bethesda is a very good example of that. There were sick people everywhere. And see, we go away thinking that the Lord just healed anybody that he came in contact with. That's not true. What you find out is when he goes to a location, at a particular location, and the people come to him, you'll find and he healed every one of them. But walking down the street, going down around, obviously he didn't heal the guy by the gate beautiful. He didn't just show up, you know, when John showed up. Peter and John, I think it was. He didn't just show up then. He'd been there. Jesus had not healed him. You see, Jesus came to earth with authority because he said yes to the Father's commission. But he did not come with power. Jesus laid aside all of his divine privileges, it says in Philippians, in order to become the Son of Man, so that while in eternity he had all authority and he had all power in eternity. But when he came as the Son of Man, the Bible says he laid all that aside.
That's right.
Isn't that what he said?
Yes.
So he had to receive power as man once he was here.
Amen.
Stay with me. He lived some 30 years without preaching or teaching or working miracles, waiting for the Father's perfect time for launching him into his ministry. As the Son of Man, though commissioned from eternity past, he received power to fulfill that commission when he was baptized at the Jordan River.
Amen.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
Look at Luke 3. One day when the crowds were being baptized, Jesus himself was baptized. As he was praying, the heavens opened and the Holy Spirit in bodily form descended on him like a dove. And a voice from heaven said, "You are my dearly loved son, and you bring me great joy."
Amen.
"Now, you are my beloved son, in you I am well pleased." Now, listen carefully. He had not done one thing yet in ministry when the Father broke through heaven and said, as one of the other translations says, "You are my beloved son, I'm well pleased with you." Hadn't done anything.
Amen.
Except the one thing that mattered.
Yes.
And that one thing that mattered is he lived 30 years being humble and in obedience to doing what his Father had told him to do.
Amen.
That's pretty heavy, church.
Yes.
So this puts the emphasis on everyday life, doesn't it?
Yes.
These are the things that please the Father.
When you are going after something, Sandra Searie's Conquering Faith will teach you how to talk, how to let faith lead you, and how to conquer it. Sandra is including her popular scripture book, which provides 51 topics for scriptural prayer and explanations of how to apply God's word so you can see a change in your circumstances. And as a point of contact to release your faith, Sandra's divinely inspired prayer cloth is also included. Order Conquering Faith today. You will be amazed at what God will do.
Look at Luke 4:1. "Then Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan River. He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness." Look at Luke 4:13 and 14. "Now when the devil had ended every temptation," remember that last verse, "he came up out of the Jordan, led by the Spirit of God to the wilderness."
Right.
"Now when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. Then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and news of him went out throughout all the surrounding region." Now, I asked the question just because it's just me asking questions. I said, well, when's the next really opportune time? Now, it doesn't mean that he wasn't tempted. No, we're talking about this level of temptation that happened in the wilderness. The next one was in the garden of Gethsemane, where he agonized, fighting against the enemy, being obedient to his Father. Now, it doesn't mean that those 3 years that he was not tempted like you and I are tempted. You and I not ever been like those 40 days in the wilderness, nor have we ever been like what happened in Gethsemane. See, Jesus came from heaven with authority and was full of the Spirit at his baptism, but he exercised power after winning over the enemy's temptations. So I could put it this way. The first thing Jesus did with his power was to overcome Satan's temptation. What temptation? Carnal temptations. You do understand that during the millennial, the devil is not here on the earth during that thousand-year reign. It says he's bound and is not on the earth. Yet at the end of the millennial, it says there's an uprising of thousands that come against Jesus. How did that happen? Carnal nature. The power of the carnal nature. Think back to Moses. You remember that when he approached Pharaoh with a simple rod and said, God told me to tell you, let my people go. And you remember Pharaoh said sarcastically, who is this God? You know, and Moses said, well, let me show you. Y'all remember all that? He told Aaron to throw his staff to the ground, and you remember they became snakes. You remember all that? And then Pharaoh wasn't impressed at all. He said, bring my boys in. So his boys came in, threw their staffs down. They became snakes. But Aaron's staff swallowed up their staffs. What's the difference? The devil is not afraid of your power, but what the devil didn't know was that Moses didn't approach Pharaoh in power. He approached him with God-given authority. Are you listening? I mean, it was God who sent him. God told him to do that. Authority, church, will eat power for lunch. Right. Don't seek after power. Devote yourself to obedience. Yes. Your authority as a disciple is imparted to you from Jesus. The results promised in his word are promises that are activated by obedience. Yes.
Yes. Amen.
Got all kind of promises. But they're not activated, no matter how much you scream and yell,
right,
unless you're walking in obedience to the Lord God Almighty.
Amen.
You can't go around commanding things to happen whenever you want them to. Believe me, I've tried it. Anybody else ever tried it? You can't go around commanding things to happen whenever you want, nor can you command things that are not aligned with the character of the Lord. James and John wanted to call down fire, y'all remember that, from heaven on the folks. Jesus rebuked them for wanting to do such.
Amen.
It didn't go with the character of the Lord, nor had they been directed by God to do such a thing.
Amen.
You remember Elijah prayed with authority and was given power to hold back the rain for 3.5 years.
Amen.
Joshua commanded the sun to stand still, and it did. Jesus spoke to a fig tree, and it withered up. This is the kind of authority we've been given, church. But the power to correctly walk in our authority flows from the Holy Spirit at work in and through us. So we must listen to the Holy Spirit. We must do things directed by Him. There's an example of this in the life of Jesus in Matthew 8. Then Jesus got into the boat, started across the lake with his disciples. Suddenly a fierce storm struck the lake. Then waves breaking into the boat, but Jesus was sleeping. The disciples went and woke him up shouting, Lord, save us, we're going to drown. Jesus responded, why are you afraid? You have so little faith. Then he got up, rebuked the wind and the waves, and suddenly there was a great calm. The disciples were absolutely amazed. Who is this man? They asked. Even the winds and the waves obey him. So Jesus stands up calmly, rebukes the storm, and just simply says three words, peace be still. Instantly, the sea relaxes as the disciples look on in shock. You know, how did that happen? Brace up when I begin to tell you. Now, I'm warning you ahead of time. Brace up. When Jesus spoke the words, "Peace, be still," the sea had to obey him because of the peace that was in him. Yeah. You can't give what you don't have. Jesus was full of peace, so when he released his peace to the sea, it had to obey.
Wow.
His internal state of peace produced an external state of calm. Upon the Sea of Galilee, because the chaos outside of him had to submit to the peace that was inside of him.
Amen.
Whoa.
Are you aware that your internal state affects the external world around you? Jesus rebuked the storm because there was a power in that storm that was not from God. And he rebuked it with words because words express authority. How do I express my authority? Words. At the same time, Jesus taught the disciples and us a very important lesson. Deal with what's inside you, because it defines what is around you.
Amen.
Listen to me. I couldn't believe this one. I said, would you repeat that one more time? He said, you will only have authority over the storm that you can sleep through.
Whoa.
When you really know everything's going to be all right. So while Jesus slept peacefully, hurricane winds were blowing, angry waves were crashing against the boat, and disciples were in full-blown panic. Their words fed their panic.
Yes.
It fed their anxiety, and it fed their fear.
Yep.
James wrote it correctly in James 1. If anyone thinks himself to be religious and yet does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is worthless. The Bible says that life and death are in the power of the tongue, and you have to decide in which direction you're going to point that tongue. You decide.
Amen.
What you're going to do with your words.
Amen.
You make that decision. Words carry great power, but to be effective, they must flow from our submission to the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're called to be mountain movers.
Amen.
Jesus gave us that authority, and we dare not think that it's only for special people. It's for every child of God who has surrendered their life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Every single one of them. Deuteronomy 28. If you listen to these commands of the Lord your God that I'm giving you today, and if you carefully obey them, the Lord will make you the head and not the tail. And you will always be on top, and you'll never be on the bottom. When we walk in our God-given authority and the power of the Holy Spirit, we are victors. We are not victims. Romans 5 tells it clearly. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege, where we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice, too, when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation, and this hope will not lead us to disappointment. For we know how dearly God loves us because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. We have authority over the demonic realm,
Amen.
Over all the power of the enemy, because Jesus said so in Luke 10. Look, he said, I've given you authority over all the power of the enemy, and you can walk among snakes and scorpions, and you can crush them. Nothing's going to injure you. So if you've been given authority, church, over all the power of the enemy, how much of his power is left for him to hurt you? Y'all not know? The answer is absolutely none. You can throw all of your weight on his words. They will never, ever fail. Wow. Glory. Jesus declared in Matthew 28, and Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore, make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. And then John the Apostle wrote, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. Jesus gave us his authority. Now, he says, you've got authority to live the way the Word says you can live. In other words, you have a right to live that way. Then he gave us power, the ability to do something. That's what power is. You have the power, the ability to be transformed into his name or to his image. So that just as he showed us the Father, we would show him to a needy and a dying world. We have the ability to do that. He's given us the power to do it and then commissioned us to do it, which is the authority to do it. Obedience is the key. In other words, if you want to see your authority work, it's not going to work outside of obedience. Obedience and being kind. But the center of obedience is worked by love. Amen. Walking in forgiveness, walking in love, authority, and power. There's not anybody in here who has not walked with your power in some arena at some point, sometime, without the authority to do it. That's just the truth. And confession's good for the soul. And it will move you forward in the things of the Lord God Almighty.